please join me in welcoming Estella to share readings from her new book.
Started about 80 years ago. Being the youngest in my family, I was fortunate to spend many extra years with my parents and siblings. And now in retrospect, I've taken upon myself to write about it. What it was like growing up around this bunch of people at this place, Leopold Shack, in the 1930s. Well, when I was a small child, Aldo Leopold was already an effective spokesman for conservation in the Midwest, if not for elsewhere. And he had this dream, which was if he could get some land along the Wisconsin River, and he and mother had been out scouting, looking for such land, where he could take his family and he could experiment with his new idea, bring to life his new idea, which was a first. Ecological restoration. And try and imagine him in 1934 standing on the podium at the University of Wisconsin and talking to an audience overlooking the farmland, which became the University Arboretum. And with him was Yellow Thunder, chief of the Winnebagoes. And I never understood why they changed their name to Ho-Chunk. I always liked the Winnebago. After Dad spoke, Yellow Thunder enthralled the audience with his discussion of the spiritual values of the land around Madison and around Baraboo. Anyway, Dad looked at this audience and said the following. We need to find out, through experimentation and reconstruction, what the original vegetation had been like in our area and what we could do to bring it back. And that led to his purchase in that year, 1934, of these 80 acres that was the shack land. And it was a place for the family to practice archery and hunt. And the title of my book, as you've heard, is Stories from the Leopold Shack by Oxford Press. And I begin this way. The shack is a small barn in south central Wisconsin that we retrofitted for camping in the 1930s and 40s. The shack has always been the hub of our family activity, at least since my childhood. And I write about the experience now looking back all the good times with my parents, Aldo and Estella, with my brothers, Stark, Luna, Carl, my sister Nina, and some of the times of sorrow, too, because we had that. And I especially wanted to record what we did to amuse and educate ourselves, and what kind of work we did that seemed to transform first one part of the land and then another. And the shack experience taught us siblings loyal, happy, and responsibly growing and learning from and coming to love this piece of land. And it became a routine. Every weekend we were up to the shack every 50 miles and put the dog in the car, get some grub. And we would visit this little barn, stood on the most desolate looking farmland abandoned cornfield, disturbed ground with weeds, and any native species left there. And we would return every Sunday night to Madison, tired and happy. In retrospect, at the shack, we lived a kind of a land ethic, as it's now called, because by planting real prairie vegetation, the soil became enriched in the best way possible. By planting native forest trees, we brought back a simile of the original cover, and the experience was reciprocal. We restored the land, and every weekend, it restored us. We would water the little pines that we planted through the droughts, and we had droughts. We had took endless walks in our woods to watch the spring migrant birds. Studied the deer browse. Well, we did that because Dad was sure to ask us, what were the deer eating today? And 10 years and thousands of pines later, the place had greened up a good deal, and it really, his approach had paid off. Well, we needed a place to camp, and so first thing is we brought up a set of tools, and the first thing we did is the boys did. They built the initial fireplace, and it's cold, but it was a place to keep warm and cook. And then we, shortly after that, rebuilt it, and there was this big process of bringing in a very heavy piece of sandstone across the lintel of the front door, with rolling it on logs to get in front of the fireplace, propping it up on two by fours, getting that up in position, and the boys eased it into position with cement, and there it stands today, a perfected fireplace. And when we built our first fire, we let out a cheer. The next thing was to take out the west wall of that little barn, and we were going to rebuild it as a bunkhouse. The boys set up benches all the way around the inside of the shack, so there were plenty of places to sit, and framed in the bunks. And I was telling some of you in the audience, we started by using snow fencing for springs. We put a canvas over that and brought in a whole load of hay from a neighbor's haystack, and put our bedrolls on top of that. So that was a very comfy place to sleep and fragrant. Now, this was a really difficult time because it was the Great Depression. And Dad, with his university salary, was not making a whole lot. And so we were trying to save money. And so we did a lot of recycling. And there was, for example, a trip to the Madison dump, where we got the kitchen table, all of the windows that went into the barn, into the shack, and what else? The front door from the Madison dump. We walked up and down the riverbanks to scout for boards, which had been served to us by the river in flood time. And Dad wrote later an essay about come high water, which was talking about an unpredictable miscellany of floatable objects pilfered from upstream farms. An old board, Dad said, has to us twice the value of the same piece from a new piece from the lumberyard. Well, it matched because the boards that came from the floodplain were the same color as the shack. Starker Leopold said that he was going to build the privy. We had some boards, we had to go get that from the lumberyard. And he was working on this, and the same day he was coming in for lunch, and he said, "You'll have to come and see this privy. It's more glorious than the Parthenon." And everybody laughed, and so we all went out to see and admired it. The name stuck. It's still the Parthenon, it's the same one. It's been moved several times, and but anyhow, it is the Parthenon. At age 9, I guess I was, I went back to school the next week and learned that there was another person on her lawn. What we did in the spring, the very first year we started plant pines, and why pines? Well, we took a trip north of our property into the anchor property and discovered a little patch of pines which were about a foot in diameter. And there were about 12 of them. They're still there. And Dad was so excited because there weren't any pines on our property. But the size of these trees told him that these were okay. These were natives. So we could plant pines. Well, he fell in love with pines. He called it an ecological landmark. Well, we had two books that we went by to tell us which species were native, and we followed them carefully, and which were not. And we ended up planting pines every spring, and in the summer, we were working on the prairie, which is a big goal of ours, to establish a real prairie on the cornfield. Well, Dad's landscape plan was to plant pines around this cornfield, and to that was a landscape plan, then the prairie would be okay on the park. Well, it was very nice. We planted in time thousands of pines, and this was the first 2 years we planted them. There were about 4,000 pines we had already planted. They all died except 5% of them. 95% dead. The third year, the rains came back because this was after the Dust Bowl years, and we began to make good pace with the pines. They were coming all right. Thank heavens. In the spring, we like to do some things very special. One of them was to hear the woodcock painting on the best painting grounds we knew, which was up upstream from our property. And we started by, first of all, listening to the spring peepers. Well, it was after supper. We would go up and listen to the woodcock. And we wanted to do this just before dusk. So then we lay on our stomachs up there in the sand in the sand area and wait for the dark to descend. And it was perfectly dark. And you could hear the bird coming and flutter in and light practically right in front of us. And right away, he began to go, beep, which is like a wine a cork in the wine gall, turning it, beep. And then in between, he'd do a little hiccup, beep, beep. And after a while, he'd start off on his sky dance, but taking off and higher he went, warbling and twirling, making these wonderful warbling noises. And in the dark, way up there, and suddenly that would stop, and he'd drop like a shot and brace himself just before he landed, just where he had been, in the dark. Well, that was sky dancing. I mean, that was really exciting. And it was thrilling to be only, you know, 5 or 6 yards from him. Then we also held our breath, you know, as he came out of the sky. What a marvelous thing. We think he never saw us, but we think he had other things on his mind. Well, summer, as I mentioned, is a time of transplanting prairie plants, and we didn't have a commercial source. Where would you go out and get, you know, the book said 150 species of native prairie species for the shack area. We were told that the railroad tracks was a good place to start because there were railroad fires that would, you know, clear the brush from the tracks, and so that we could go in there and presumably find plenty of prairie species. And that's what we did. And we took some buckets. It didn't seem to matter much taking a few cuts out of the railroad track buff area. So we bring these in and spud them in the cornfield. Of course, some of the species would eventually grow very deep roots, such as the Silphium. And Dad's story in the essay called Prairie Birthday talks about his effort to dig out a potato tape type, yam type root under the Sylvian plant, which was very difficult to follow, but he said it went straight to China. So obviously he should plant the seeds, which he did, and he mixed with some grasses. He did a little experiment on the hill right above the shack and put in sprinkling of grasses and asters and seeds from the Sylvian plant. And lo and behold, without any water, the next year they came up. And when we go up into this area, we see this quadrat of perfectly beautiful prairies right in the middle of the sand up there on the hill. Crazy. Well, one of the things we learned was that the Lands Institute in Kansas said that prairie herbs would send roots down 10 to 18 feet below the surface. 10 feet below the surface. So no wonder prairie ecotones are so stable as a system in terms of drought. Another thing we liked to do was call to the owls, and there was a place we liked to do that. Up on top of the hill above the shack was a, still is, a very large boulder. It's about 5 feet long, and we'd go up there after supper, and Carl, who's very good at this, would get up on this boulder and like to talk to the owls very loudly, especially to barred owls. So it was something like this. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo! And sometimes, we're on this rock, which was brought up by the last glacier and parked on our hill. And we had a very good time with it. Dean and I would always be along and try and imitate, as Carl was better at it than me. But anyhow, then we sometimes hear some horned owls answering, which would be a more sonorous, deeper sound. So, woo, 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 woo. Woo, 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 woo. We were always delighted when the barred owls flew a little closer and answered, all excited to see who was entering their territory. As I said, Nina and I thought that Carl was so good at it, we were trying to imitate him as well as the owls. In the winter, we like to cut oak, good oak, down in the river floodplain, upstream from the shack. And then we would haul it on a sled down in the shack for burning and keep us warm in the winter. And but sometimes it was hard to get into the shack. After a big snowstorm, we would park at the uphill, upstream end of the property at Joe Lewis's farm and ski a mile and a half in. And there was Mother in a skirt and a hat. She never wore pants over at the shack. She was always very well dressed. And sometimes with a concha belt, she was all right. When we were preparing for cutting wood, we had all these tools. And one of them was an especially long-handled two-end saw, a double bit, two regular axes, a sledgehammer, and two wedges, steel, iron wedges. And we would be splitting some of this stuff because they're so heavy to put them on a sled before we hauled them to the shack. Well, it turns out that when you're banging on these wedges trying to split the wood, you'd hear this great crack and ting, and the wedge would fly to the ground. And right away you smell vinegar smell. And this is the freshly cut oak, the good oak smell is wonderful. So one of the things we love to do, especially in the winter, was talk to the chickadees. When we were working there at the woodcutting site, and they came to us because they would look for insects in the freshly opened good oak, and ants and these kind of insects. And they would call to us, and we talked to them. We thought they were wonderful. One of them, we began to band the birds back at the Leopold shack on the table, where we had a little wire box with a stick and food underneath for the birds. We get over in the shack and pull the string, and when the bird got into the trap, we pull the string and rush out there and cut the little bird. And to pick a tiny, soft, breathing bird with beady eyes, and read his band and let him go. That was an unbelievable experience. His dad said, to band a bird is to hold a great ticket in a great lottery. We got to know some of these birds very well, and one of them Dad called Greenhorn, because he had one band which was silver, Fish and Wildlife Band, and one was a green plastic. And he would just love to come into our trap and get a free meal. So, oh, that's Greenhorn, so just let him go. So, and we loved to talk with them, and they loved their calls. Chipper, 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 dee, dee, dee. Spring soon. The real payoff, of course, was burning the good oak around the fire at night while we were trying to harness the summer sun with our Dutch oven cooking by the fire. And on a winter evening, it might be soon time to get out the guitar and tune up the guitar and think about summer. Well, the last part of my book is about the fall hunting experiences, and they were some of them pretty rare. How we started the Aldo Leopold Foundation and find staff that would help us by continuing our restoration and planting activities, and especially to thin the pines. That was what was really important, because they were getting very thick. We found Buddy in this operation. He's been with us many years here. It's really great. You weren't a fellow, though. You were. We hired you first. You could have been a fellow, too. He has been leading us in this wonderful work that we're talking about with Herb and Denise. And I'd like to say that, in conclusion, that the shack idea is an important one. Each of us five siblings, as we matured and went on with our professional lives and went to different parts of the country, carried with us a hankering to have a place of our own, a shack of our own, as it were. And I think at the Wisconsin Shack, we each realized there was a fundamental connection between the human spirit and our landscape. And it wasn't really just real estate, of course. Instead, it was a place where the opportunity to be close to the land, to work with it, to look at it, occasionally watch it. It was an experience in simplicity, because we got up there with sitting long in the outdoors with very little gear, very little belongings. Mother said, never bring anything up here unless you really need it. For example, school books were brought, but we never opened them. Well, the importance of all this, of course, and a great theme for us as an audience, is thinking about the importance of the wild for children. And to be out alone in nature, it seemed to me, is an example of where one can be oneself. I wonder if that experience is not going to disappear, because we see more and more world people going in groups in nature, or even not at all, which is worse. A rejection for a child not to be able to wander and explore the woods because it might be dangerous seems like a new idea of denial. And what may be lost is the chance for the kid to develop an appreciation, a sense of community with the land. And there is, of course, a connection between enjoyment in nature and developing caring values. To visit the very same land, and this was the main idea we had at the shack, is to over and over through the seasons, the same place, to watch the same plants come into bloom each spring and to welcome them and their pollinating insects. That's an experience special and a privilege. And over time, these plants, these butterflies, these birds that appear on our land in a celestial schedule, in this community, it builds the idea of awareness of the interdependence of the species. And one feels a great sense of the community of life with this experience. To watch and hear the migrants, such as the elegant sandhill cranes or even the house wrens, returning to one's land from someplace south is so special because they've each flown thousands of miles to come back to your farm. These delightful avian fauna belong on this land, and the land is poorer without them. And I'd like to quote Robert Pyle, who's a wonderful ecologist and naturalist in Washington State, talking about his land and the migrant birds, and he said, "If you wait long enough, they all come home." That marvelous. So as youngsters, we had the great challenge to do right by the land that we made our own. And we learned love for that land and all that grew on it. And the shack experience gave us that rare commodity, a sense of place in an ecological community. Thank you all very much.